So mammalogy is the study of mammals, mammals being animals that suckle their young on milk. In fact, the name or the word mammal is derived from a Latin word, mamma, and humans are mammals. We also suckle our young. And of course, there are other characteristics such as hair and differences in bone structure and so on that make us mammals and make us special. My name is Dr. Sandy Ingleby. I'm the collection manager in the mammal section at the Australian Museum, the Australian Museum Research Institute, or AMRI as we're called. A mammal is basically a vertebrate animal, so it's an animal with a backbone. They're placed in the class Mammalia. There are a number of other features that characterise mammals, such as having a single bone in the lower jaw, three bones in the inner ear, which enhances hearing, being warm-blooded or homeothermic like birds, so that they have internal control of their body temperature and don't rely on external environment to keep warm. It's the presence of hair or fur on their bodies. Even whales at some point have hair on their bodies. Having a diaphragm in their chest cavity is another advantage that mammals have, as is having a well-developed brain. And all these features have made mammals one of the most successful animal groups. Mammalogy itself can be broken up into a whole range of different kind of topics, things like taxonomy, the naming and describing of species, systematics, the study of the relationships between the different groups, but also things like diet, distribution, physiology, reproductive biology, behaviour, ecology, and so many other different fields. Living mammals are divided into three broad groups based on how they reproduce. There's the monotremes that lay soft-shelled eggs. This is the platypus and the echidna species. The second group are the marsupials, also known as metatherians. Marsupials give birth to poorly developed, almost embryonic young, which complete their development in a pouch or attached to a teat. And the third group, the largest group, are placental mammals like humans that give birth to more developed young. So mammals are a very diverse group. They range in size from the gigantic blue whales at over 30 metres down to tiny bats and shrews at less than a few grams. Mammals have also radiated to occupy most of the planet. They occur in almost every habitat. They're on the land, in the oceans. They can fly and swim and hop and burrow, run very fast. It's very hard to estimate the exact number of mammals there are in the world because the number's constantly changing. But currently the estimates are around 6,500 species. So in the last 40 years or so, there's been a 50% increase in the number of mammal species described. Every year new mammal species are being described, even in Australia where we think, you know, we know them fairly well. By far the most species of mammals are actually rodents. Our livestock make up something like 62% of all the biomass, that is the bulk of mammals on the planet. Humans are 34%. Wild mammals only make up around 4% of all mammals on the planet, which is why they're so special, because they're just that's a lot of biodiversity in a very small group, and that's why it's so important to preserve them. Mammals are one of the most threatened groups of animals. Around a third of all mammal species worldwide are threatened with extinction. So historically we have a terrible record of mammal extinction in Australia. Part of it is habitat loss, and part of it is due to invasive species such as cats and foxes are really big ones. In other parts of the world, hunting is a major factor. So things like elephants, rhinos, pangolins. In Australia, we lost the thylacine. It was basically hunted as well because it was considered a pest. Pollution is another factor. And more recently, climate change is emerging as a factor that's threatening mammals. The Australian Museum has one of the most extensive collections of Australian and Pacific mammals in the world. The collection dates back to sort of the mid-1800s or so, and it's continuing to grow. So we're adding new specimens every year. We have around 57,000 specimens. Around half of those are what we call dry skin, skull, skeletons, and the other half are wet specimens, so whole animals preserved in alcohol. And we also have an extensive frozen tissue collection, and each of these different types of specimens has a different purpose for research. There are several main uses of the collection, if you like it. So it's for research, for education, and it's also as a historical archive. The specimens themselves are almost like a physical representation of the environment. So they were collected at a particular point in time and a particular place. And we can't go back in time and collect that specimen again. And that's why the specimens are so important, because they allow us to document those changes throughout time. That sort of information is what can help us inform decisions about conservation. So we're fortunate at this museum in having several very high quality mammal researchers. We have a principal research scientist in mammals who uses the collection for his particular research on molecular ecology and population genetics of a whole range of species, in particular rock wallabies and tree kangaroos.
The museum really is this vast library of DNA through time and through space that you're now able to access using molecular techniques. So I'd call myself a molecular ecologist. That is, I use DNA techniques, I use genetic techniques to help us understand about the biology, about the ecology of mammals. So how they're related to each other, how they move around the landscape, their reproductive strategies, and questions like that you can now get at through DNA technologies. So we can actually put, you know, like extinct species or really rare species into our analyses, which we weren't able to do before from a genetic perspective.
So most people are familiar with the public areas in the museum where we have mammals in lifelike positions. That's only a tiny fraction of the specimens we have that are made to look lifelike. There are a number of challenges though in putting specimens on display. Probably the most important one is the environmental conditions, for instance, such as light. If specimens are on display for a long time and the lighting is too high, they will fade. They will literally go white if they're on display for a long time. This will seem strange from coming from a person that works in a museum, but yeah, I do. I do really love wild mammals, seeing just the diversity and the beauty and the variety, the unique characteristics of them. They're just very, very charismatic. I think Attenborough said, I'm never so happy as when I'm contemplating nature. I could say the same thing. I'm never so happy as when I'm looking at mammals.